Alright, there we go. Hello everyone, how's it going? Team here, and this is BXJS Weekly, a JavaScript news podcast, bringing you the best news of the week, and today we have an episode 19 already. Man, that's like a lot of episodes. We've been doing this for quite some time, and well, since it's July, we don't really have that much stuff today. Hey Mikkel, welcome to the stream. Yeah, so as I said, no worries, man. I always make stupid typos as well, especially people names. It's always super embarrassing. Not a big deal. Right, so coming back to the news. We don't really have that much stuff today. There are some news, but you know, it's middle of July, so what do you expect? People are on vacations. Nonetheless, we got some stuff, so let's just start looking at it, right? So first thing we got is an article called Pointer Events with React, the Why, How, and What. Exactly what you expect. The article talks about the pointer events, the new thing that's been added in React 16.2, I think. We covered it at some point on the releases section within React. But basically, the pointer events are the synthetic React events that combine the pen, touch, and mouse events into one nice pointer event that you can use universally on all the platforms, right? This article just goes looking in depth into how exactly it works, what kind of events does it combine, how they differ, and how you can use them within your React application. 16.4 it was. Okay, so it was a bit later. And how exactly you can use them within your application, even with a bit of a code samples here using Create React App. Turns out the Create React App has a really nice additional tool where you can enable pointer events by running, where was the example? Here we go. Create React App, React Pointer, React Event Pointers, which is pretty neat, I thought. I didn't know about that feature, but I'm not a heavy user of Create React App. As you might know, I prefer Next.js. So yeah, if you are looking into pointer events in React, then definitely have a look at this article. It will give you a pretty comprehensive overview. Okay, next thing we got is building an image editor with Canvas API. Exactly what the title says, it's a tutorial on how to build an image editor, not necessarily photo editor, but yeah, any image basically using Canvas.js. It's going to be mobile friendly. You're going to have a zoom, pan, and draw functionalities. It is very basic, but it does give you a pretty good introduction on how to work with Canvas essentially, and how to, you know, pan and zoom images and how to draw over them using the very basic Canvas drawing, right? So it's pretty simple, but yeah, if you never worked with Canvas or if you want to get into online image editing, then this might be a good place to start. All right, next thing we got is the end of life of Internet Explorer 11. A pretty interesting article that I didn't know, like the author talks about the IE11, right? And the when is gonna die and what's the problem with it and so on and so forth. There's a bunch of really interesting facts here. The first thing being that it's kind of an immortal browser because the Microsoft said they will only they will support IE11 as long as the Windows 10 is supported, which is considering they said Windows 10 is going to be like operating system as a service, is probably going to be years. So I'm not sure if I'm happy about that. On the other hand, you know, IE11 is still getting updated, at least a tiny bit, at least like patches. I mean, Edge is way more developed right now, right? So this gets like all the new features and all the new cool stuff. I am kind of curious. I mean, I do understand why they are doing this, right? And there's also some reasoning here in the article that, you know, there are enterprises that depend on that browser and that are used to it and they cannot really switch from it. And Microsoft, purely because they are paid by those guys, they have to support it, right? On the other hand, I think Microsoft is big enough to just force it off the market, and that would be better for everyone. Honestly, like, I might be missing something that, you know, and it's not going to be painless for sure, but I think in the long run, it's going to be more benefits than negatives. It's like, yeah, there's going to be a lot of screaming and crying, but I mean, IE11 is not the worst browser, let's be honest, right? So if you ever work with IE8 or, God forbid, IE6, you know what's the bad browser are, right? So IE11 is not too terrible, but the further on we go, the more ECMAScript technologies, like the new specs we get, the worth it will become, right? Because like, I think, does IE11 actually support proxies, for example? So this is a good question for you. IE11 proxy. It's, no, wait. ES6 proxy is what I want. You can polyfill it? I thought it's impossible to polyfill. Does not require object observe. Wait, are you for real? Did the Google guys just create a proxy polyfill that actually works in old browsers? No. No way. Okay, I will have to look at that, but that is, I thought it was impossible to polyfill. Limited, okay, so it's just a partial polyfill basically, right? I see, okay. Property, okay, so it's just the, okay, I see, that makes sense. Yeah, so you can do that. So it's basically, it allows you to use proxy on the objects that are already fixed and the properties exist at the creation time by enumerating over them, I imagine. But there we go. MDN proxy. This is what I was looking for. I should have looked at the MDN from the beginning, and there should be a table for the browser support. And yep, Internet Explorer does not support it at all. So that's one of the problems, right? So there are already some features that are not there, basically. And the further we go, the more of them will be there, or I guess won't be in IE11. So that's kind of a problem. Let's see how that goes. Let's see how that develops. But if you're interested in the whole browser markets or browser landscape, let's put it this way, then this article is quite interesting and has a lot of very cool and eye-opening points, I guess, here, because there are some things that I didn't know about the inner workings of Microsoft and, you know, Windows and IE. I guess more from a business side than developer side. All right, continuing, we got JavaScript Essentials, the engine. That is an article that goes into a very specific use case, I guess, and very specific explanation of the optimizations the engine does to the JavaScript code, right? So there's the two bits of code, like you have this bunch of objects, right? You have an array of people. They all have the same properties, and then you execute some codes a lot of times. It's like 1 billion here, right? And that is done in 1.2 seconds. Then you add another property to those objects and make them non-uniform, meaning they now have different properties, right? And then you execute the same loop, and all of a sudden it takes 8 times longer, essentially. A bit less than 8 times, but 7 times, yeah? And this article goes into the look why. How does the engine works? How interpreter and compiler work together to optimize your code, and how you can actually optimize it in this specific case, which I thought is really cool. So the answer here is by using a class which provides a uniform data structure, which has all of those properties, so the compiler can actually optimize for it, which is pretty neat because I was not aware of that, but you know, I never hit bottlenecks like this, so I never actually investigated this. But anyway, if you're interested in the details, make sure to read the article. There are some really cool insights into the workings of compiler and interpreter. Right, continuing, we got Ember 2 years on. Retrospective article on working with Embers, essentially after 2 years. And we had a bunch of those on React, and now we finally have on something different, like Ember, you know. It's also a framework that is decently popular, I guess mostly along the Ruby guys, because it is baked in with Ruby on Rails, if I remember correctly. So there's a lot of points or author lists, what he actually liked, what he didn't like, and what kind of, yeah, so basically his clothing thoughts, right? So it's quite straightforward, and I think the overall gist here is more or less the same as the impression I had. So I never worked extensively with Ember, but I, like I say, I typically do with all the at least somewhat popular libraries, frameworks. I look at them, I go through the tutorial, and I try to build something. Ember is very object-oriented thing, and then the author also says he would love to see more functional programming, because I also, you know, I don't really, not a huge fan of object-oriented programming, and I also prefer functional approaches wherever possible. So, but yeah, coming back to the article, if you are looking into Ember or you are interested in what kind of problems or advantages you will see a couple of years working with it, then have a look at this article. It will give you an understanding of it. Right, moving on, we got Essential Chrome Developer Tools, Beginner to Master, yet another Chrome Dev Tools 101 article. Again, very, very lengthy one, because as we already established, Chrome Dev Tools are amazingly complex and powerful thing that, again, if you haven't learned about all the features that it has, you should read that. Like, there is so many things you can do with it that it's like, I still, every time I see some tips, I discover something new, because there's like tiny obscure features that you would not know unless you go very deep in the documentation from DevTools, right? But there are some things that I use on a daily basis, like, you know, the breakpoint debugging or code expanding, like, what was it called correctly? Deobfuscation, right? So if you didn't know, you can actually have a look at the source code here, right? And if you open the minified source code, see, it's minified, right? You can just press a pretty print button and you get a nicely printed source. So it's basically prettier integrated into the DevTools. I'm not sure if it's prettier itself, but you know, at least it formats it nicely. So you won't get the nice variable names, but you can read it way better than obfuscated one, right? So yes, again, if you are looking to learn more about DevTools, which you should, definitely have a look at this article. It will give you some good starting points for just about all of the panels that are currently present in the DevTools. All right, next thing we got is Node REPL in depth. Again, this is a tutorial for Node REPL. There are some features that are highlighted that I did not know about, like these special commands, for example, that exist. I already said that a number of times, I think, but I should really look at the official Node docs and just learn all of them or read through all of them, because apparently there are special commands that you can execute in the REPL that will do like save it to file, load it from file, open the editor mode, which you can interrupt with Control D like here. You know, you can actually write the full code. And yeah, auto loads, auto imported modules, and so on and so forth. There's like so much things, and this is a quite basic intro, so there's obviously a link to the full REPL docs, which again I think I should also read, because that just looks, I should read that. So yes, if you are heavily using Node REPL, I wouldn't say I am heavily using it, but I do use it from time to time, then this would be a pretty good article to read to learn about some of the intricacies of. Right, next thing we got is upcoming ES features part 1 and part 2. This is a two-part article highlighting the upcoming ES Next, or I guess, I'm not sure if you call it ES Next anymore, it's ECMAScript, right? So the new ECMAScript features. ES Next was the ES 2015, but that's not Next anymore, so whatever. Let's just continue. So basically, it highlights the upcoming features of the ECMAScript and shows some, you know, explains what they do and shows some examples. So pipelines is something I'm extremely excited for. I think it's still like stage one, even if not less, but I'm not sure. Like the syntax is super straightforward. You basically pipe data into a function, and it's equivalent of compose in functional programming, which essentially is calling one function upon the output of another function. So it's really straightforward, and the fact that you can use it with a weight, the fact that you can actually give it a parameters, like the placeholders, right, is really, really cool. So this is a feature that I heavily used, for example, in Elixir. So like, right, Elixir, I think it was Elixir, right? Am I forgetting things? Elixir pipeline. I think Elixir, they do have pipe operators, so I'm just don't want to lie about things that I've used. So Elixir already has it baked in, and it's like, it's not the only language, and it makes functional programming way, 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 way easier and nicer and more readable, right? Because you no longer have like billions of function calls, you just have this nice hierarchy over here that you can read. And this is like something that I'm quite excited about. So partial application is another thing. This is again placeholders, so they are this is something I think that came out of the pipeline operators function. And the thing is that, you know, when you call a function, you should be able to provide a placeholder, right? So this is, instead of doing bind with one parameter, you can do this. So it will actually effectively be bind with A as one and B undefined, which means that you can just pass another value there, right? So very straightforward, and it works amazingly well with pipeline function. Decorators, this is something I think we already talked more than one time. They've been in, they've been moved around the stages for like hell what knows how many times, and they are still not finalized. They are getting there. I think there's not that many problems left, but essentially a decorator is this thing that starts with at and then execute. Essentially it's a function wrapper, right? So you just, there's this observed function that is called upon this thing, and that's basically all it does if you look underneath it, right? It's a very simple concept, but it's just a nicer way of doing it instead of, you know, saying that render equals a function that is bound and then you pass an argument to it. So it's like, and then you have to bind this, and then it gets annoying, basically, right? So this is a way cleaner way of doing that, and a very object-oriented thing, basically, right? So you don't really see those much in functional programming. All right, next thing we got is the part two, which talks about the bind operator, which, again, I think have been there since, like, ES 2016, 15, maybe even, and been moved around the stages for ages as well. The syntax is super simple, so it's essentially you can do this, right? So you can bind the console log to console, or you can just say bind console log, which will auto bind it to itself. And then you can bind something to like function call to the elements, right? So this is the basic idea behind it. It's just a sugar for the bind syntax, right? Nothing complicated here. I mean, it's nice, especially for like stuff like React. You don't really need that anymore because we have arrow functions now in classes. So it's like, yeah, okay. Top level await. This is something a lot of people have been asking for, and a lot of people have been saying it's a foot gun that will shoot back, and you know, it's going to be bad and it's going to break things. I'm still not sure. I mean, one thing I can tell you, I really like it. So I like how this index looks. I don't know if it will backfire. I guess if you throw early, like, you know, the way that Node will, works with the promises now, so basically on any exceptions, it throws and breaks the, exits the Node process, it will be okay because you can catch those errors early. If it would be the old way when the promise errors were eaten, it was like Node 6, I think, right? That would be a problem for sure. Your code would just like be silently non-working, right? Because this is promise essentially. So that might have been a problem, but I don't... Maybe I'm just missing some things, and maybe there are some other problems that I don't see immediately, but I really kind of like this idea. And you already have the top level await in the console here, right? So you can actually await promise, like new promise. You can actually await it here and it works fine. But again, console is not exactly the Node script, right? We're gonna see how that ends up. Right, last thing we got is optional chaining, which is also something I'm quite excited about. I remember from the time I was programming in C#, that was incredibly useful. The idea is that instead of checking for properties yourself, so imagine we have this person home world name, you have to check for home world first, and then if it will be proper, you actually have to check if the person exists, because person might not exist, right? And then you have this huge and, which is annoying. So instead of that, you can just use a question mark at the end of the property. So actually, in reality, you would want to do a person question mark, homework question mark, name, right? Or unknown. And it also allows you to do like expressions or function calls and so on and so forth, which is really, really awesome. It's already available as a Babel plugin. It's stage one, so it's like quite far away from getting there, I guess. But there doesn't seem to be any specific problems with it, so it's probably going to move to stage two quite soon. But yeah, those are quite neat features, and I'm quite excited about seeing them in the actual spec, so we're going to see how that develops. All right, continuing, we got JavaScript ES6, which is, I think that's basically tautology, right? You don't really need to learn generators, but you should read this anyway. I would say you don't really need to learn generators, but you should learn them anyway. Not exactly, not especially from this article, just learn about them anyway because they might be useful. So the article is essentially introduction to generators and how do they differ from promises and how do you basically use them, right, in a very basic version. So again, if you didn't know about generators, if you wanted to learn about them, or you, maybe you wanted an introduction, Do you have a look at this article? It is not, like, it's quite good. It's not terrible, let's put it this way. And it will give you all the basics you need to know about the generators, and then you might, you know, read more about them. I guess, I don't know. I mean, the thing is with async await, as the author correctly notes, you don't always need generators. Like, they have very limited application scope. And so far, I've been, at least in my cases, I've been using async await pretty much successfully for just about everything I needed. So I don't really know if I would ever need them, but yeah, who knows? I mean, there are definitely use cases that it cannot really do with promises. All right, continuing. We got get better type checking in JavaScript with maybe type, or maybe monad if you prefer that version. So this essentially is an introduction to maybe monad or maybe type if you prefer, and how to use it on a very basic level. So it uses this Crox maybe implementation, which is this one. It is a repository containing algebraic data types in JavaScript, including maybe, including nothing, including all the other monadic data types that you basically will work with if you are into the functional programming. This article specifically focuses on the maybe type and shows you how you can actually work with it and what happens if, you know, so like maybe nothing, maybe value, how you can iterate over it, how you can expand it, how you can handle these nothingness and so on and so forth. So it's a, like, if you never worked with, if you never heard about maybe, if you never heard about monads, if you never heard about functional programming, this might be a very good point to learn about the usefulness of the whole thing, right? Because it does simplify your code a lot if you need to work with the unsafe data, basically, right? So there's some interesting things here, basically. So if you are interested in this kind of stuff, to have a look, you probably will learn something new. All right, continuing, we got JavaScript framework comparison with examples, React, Vue, and HyperApp. Exactly what you would imagine from the title. This article compares a bunch of very basic, how to put it? I mean, I wouldn't call it apps, very basic components, I guess, or examples built in three different frameworks, React, Vue, and Hyper. And you can see this source code side by side. So all of them have like full implementations. You got, I think, three or four examples. First one is like the counter. You got the fetching data from REST API, and you got the to-do list item examples. Again, you got like React functional, React component, HyperApp functional, and Vue component. And yeah, then there's some additional comparison of the frameworks themselves, like the methods, lifecycle methods, like the performance comparison. And I think this, like, yeah, it's taken from the JS framework benchmark, so it's more or less, I guess, you could rely on that for real world use cases. But then again, you know, it's like with the benchmarking, it's always especially with these differences between the frameworks, I would say you should not care about this until you actually hit that bottleneck. So it's like, it's a waste of time, to be honest. But it's always nice to see those kind of comparisons, and it's always nice to see the benchmarks, because it pushes people, framework developers, and maintainers to be better and create better results, basically, right? So yeah, that's a pretty neat comparison. So if you were wondering which of the frameworks is your thing, do have a look. Maybe you will. Maybe this article will help you figure it out. Right, continuing. How I built a job scraping web app using Node.js. Exactly what it says is a tutorial, or I guess walkthrough, not a tutorial, of how the author built a web scraping app using Express.js and Node and Axios for Axios for requests, Express as a server, handlebars for templating, and MDL for the as a UI framework. It's a quite detailed step-by-step tutorial, basically, that walks you through the whole thing and how to create it. And I mean, I wouldn't call it scraping, actually, because in reality, the author just queries the jobs API. So it's more of a, let me take this API and make a nice website out of it, which is still quite useful. You know, if you are looking into doing something like this, this will give you a pretty good understanding how to do that. And yeah, it's a decent tutorial. All right, next thing we got is sets in JavaScript. Again, JavaScript ES6. Why is this a thing? Why is this even... JavaScript ES6 is not... Okay, whatever. Let us just talk about sets. So this article is introduction to sets in ES6, right? Sets is a new thing. And if you never heard the term set, it's the collection that cannot... Like the collection of unique items, right? So this is the strict definition of it. So I'm personally typically using sets when I need to when I need to filter the array of strings, IDs, or whatever into the unique array of unique IDs. Usually, I usually works with strings. I think works really well. You just take array, you convert it to set, and then you convert it back to array, and you have a nice array of without any duplicates. So this is one application that is really easy to do. So this article goes in depth into showing how the sets work, showing the methods it has, and explaining how the how the comparison between the elements done, because it won't actually compare the objects. So this is something that will always be duplicated even if you push the same object multiple times. The problem is it uses object is for comparison, and object is doesn't really compare the objects in depth, right? So we'll always return false. And yeah, so again, if you're interested in sets, that's a pretty good article. Do have a look. You will probably learn quite a lot of new things. All right, next thing we got is introducing lock points and auto attach in VS Code. A bunch of improvements to debugging in VS Code, essentially. Essentially the article goes into first talking about the pain points that people typically have when debugging using VS Code. One of them being that you actually have two configs there, right? You have the launch config and you have the attach config, which was like for me, it was also extremely confusing at first when I started reading the docs. Like I figured it out at some point, but man, it was like very confusing. So they are introducing the auto attach into node processes, which means that you can just set the auto attach to true, and you see auto attach is on. And then you just run your node as usually from the terminal, right, with a debug flag, and that's it. The VS Code will actually catch your node process and attach to it automatically, which is just incredible. Like, I am absolutely amazed every time those guys show anything. Like, this is just so neat. So yes, you can now painlessly debug your node apps. So we will also do the same thing with npm script. So you now also have a convenient debug button over there. And the next thing is the log points. I think we already talked about them at some point. They had a separate post about it, but the cool thing is that now when debugging, you can not only make the breakpoint, but you can also add a log point, which instead of debugging, or instead of breaking there, the code will actually output the value of the given line, right? So in this case, you can see the return of the Fibonacci function, which is quite useful. And it's nicer than using console log, and you won't actually leave any console logs in your code base anymore when using this. So yeah, as you can see here, there's a list of supported languages. So there's like Node, Chrome, Firefox, whatever. There's quite a lot of them actually. And I think those are all official debug components from Microsoft. No, not all of them. Okay, most of them are official, but some of them are not official, which makes it even cooler. So it's actually easy enough for third-party people to implement it. So that's pretty cool. All right, next thing we got is Twitter sentiment analysis using Node.js. A very simple tutorial on doing Twitter sentiment analysis using the sentiments module, sentiment module in npm, which is the Finn-based sentiment analysis, which means it's very, very simple and quite stupid, but you know, for the basic versions, it works fine. And then it's just, I think they basically just get the specific tweets by keywords, and it's just the one fixed request, right? So if you're interested in doing this on streams, then have a look at my data science course. We did that for the streaming, like the fetching the tweets from the stream and then doing the sentiment analysis using the core NLP Stanford library, which is way, way, way better than a Finn-based approaches. All right, continuing, we got WTF is this, understanding the this keyword call apply and bind in JavaScript. Exactly as it says, this is a tutorial, pretty extensive one, as you can see from the size, on this keyword. And if you like, there is a video here. So if you enjoy watching videos more, you can do that. And yeah, it is pretty in-depth. So if you are still confused about what this is, what are implicit, explicit bindings, and so on and so forth, then and how, you know, what's the difference between call, apply, and all the stuff like this, do have a look. This article does explains it pretty well. All right, next thing we got is extensive guide to creating streams in RxJS. Once again, as the title suggests, it's a pretty long guide, like just look at the size of this thing, on handling streams in RxJS. So if you're not familiar with RxJS, that's probably not the best place to start. It does gives you a bit of introduction as to what the library actually does, but I guess you could start here. It's just going to be a bit tricky. But yeah, it basically shows you how to work, how to make streams from RxJS, how to handle it, how to wrap the sockets, AJAX calls, how to use subjects, and all the kind of things that you might want to do when working with data. If you are not familiar with RxJS at all, I guess you could start here and then go from here, because I mean, RxJS is an extremely powerful and complicated library, or I guess not complicated, complex would be the better word here. And yeah, it does work incredibly well with when you have to work with the streams of data, meaning the data distributed over time, right? So promises work really well when you have something that executes after some time, but once, and then RxJS is basically when you have something that executes over time multiple times, right? So you can think of it as a promise that can resolve multiple times. This, I guess, it's a terrible way to put it, but this kind of describes it. So yeah, definitely worth learning, and the article does give you a pretty good introduction to at least creating and handling streams. Right, next thing we got is what is JSX from Mr. Kenzie Dots. A very basic introduction to what is JSX and how exactly it works. Again, if you're still not sure what it is, if you never touched React, this would be a really good starting point. It does explains how the JSX... Does explains how JSX tags compile to actual JavaScript and how you can write it by hand, basically, right? So it's quite easy and very, very simple explanation. So you have a look there. All right, continuing, we got the perils of using a common Redux anti-pattern. Talk about the probably the most common, yeah, pitfall, or I guess it's an anti-pattern. Wouldn't call it a pit. Maybe it's a pitfall. When you work with a Redux, and the idea is that when you organize your view action creator and reducers, you group them like this, and this is actually not very good because then you have your actions tied to the view, which actually should not be the case, right? So they should make sense. They should not just be tied to the view, and then view just knows everything about whatever the hell should happen, right? There's a pretty in-depth explanation of the pitfall itself. There's a pretty in-depth explanation how to evade that. So if you are heavily working with Redux, you are looking to make your code better, if you're looking for better organizational structure and so on and so forth, do have a look. There's some quite interesting things in here. All right, next thing we got is testing Node.js in 2018. Very generic title, but I found it interesting because it is from the stream guys, who are, well, they are a pretty large company, right? So they do this activity feeds on demand, which you don't have to build yourself. You can just use a third-party API if you're building whatever. And they are primarily Go and Python company, right? So they've written a Vince2o service that is built on Node. And the whole article is essentially insights from Go and Python people. Those are, bear in mind, two languages that have a completely different approaches to testing than Node.js. So those are the insights of how you actually test Node.js from the perspective of people coming from Go and Python land. What kind of things can you expect? What kind of tools you can use? What kind of pain is there? What kind of things that I'm basically missing? At least, you know, like limitations, I guess, is a better word here. Yeah. It's really interesting. So if you are, again, curious about testing or maybe heavily involved in testing or like testing, then have a look. There are some very interesting things here and there. You probably won't find any tools here. So it's mostly an experience description, right? All right, next thing we got is using Amazon Web Services Lambda and Node.js to scan your S3 uploads. Essentially a tutorial on setting up your own antivirus scanner using Amazon Lambda and for scanning the uploads to S3. Kat, can you please not block my screen? I cannot see anything. Thank you very much. Okay, so yeah, it talks about, so you have this setup where the user uploads something to S3 bucket, and then you have to make sure that it's actually not malicious, right? So it talks about the Clam AV, which is a free and open source antivirus, and then it talks about using the Lambda function to actually run this Clam AV on the upload to make sure that it's actually not malicious. And the whole thing is like pretty well described. There's like some optimizations and caveats and stuff like this, and obviously the source code on GitHub if you're interested. So if you're interested in this kind of stuff, do have a look. It's quite a good write-up. All right, next thing we got is announcing npm.community. The npm just released a new website that is basically, yeah, a public issue tracker for npm and discussions for ideas, bugs, and whatever problems with npm you can imagine. And as you can see here, it's I think, what was the name of this platform? I keep seeing it everywhere. Discourse, right? This is what everyone's been using. So it's a discourse forum essentially set up for npm discussions. I'm not sure how useful that will be, but we're gonna see how that develops. Right, next thing we got is Reflectly from React Native to Flutter. I thought it would be interesting to also like note another React Native story. Again, people transitioning from React Native to a different framework and giving their retrospective on why that happened, how that happened, and whether they are actually happy with that. So if you're working with React Native or Flutter, do have a look. There are some interesting thoughts in here, some interesting points, and even a wish list for the Flutter development, I guess. So yeah, some pretty cool stuff. Always really cool to see articles like this, basically talking about people's experience. Right, next thing we got is WebAssembly is more than the web. Talking about that, yes, indeed, WebAssembly is just not just for browsers and not just for the web, right? So talking about that Ring Zero kernel that we already looked at some point. Yes, written in Rust. I think it was the same one, right? I believe it is. Hell of a, maybe there's a different one? I don't remember, but we already seen something like this on the podcast. But yeah, you already know my points, You already know my point of view on that. I do think that WebAssembly is going way beyond just the web, and it's gonna be, they have like the largest impact is gonna be within the Node infrastructure, and it's gonna empower JavaScript even more. That's kind of my point of view. But yeah, if you're interested, do have a look here. There's a bunch of quite interesting links and thoughts about the possibilities of using WebAssembly outside of the web platform. All right, next thing we got is Postmortem for malicious packages published on July 12th. If you didn't know, July 12th, ESLint scope package was compromised. Oh, there's actually two packages that was compromised. Or rather, one of the collaborators' account was compromised. The credentials were stolen. And those two packages was published with a malicious code that actually stolen your NPMRC contents, which means your oath token or access tokens. And there hasn't been that many people affected. I think there was like 4,000 or 5,000 accounts, that's at least what I remember from the Twitter. And NPM already reacted on it and reset the passwords and so on and so forth. The cool thing is, first of all of this was resolved within an hour, I think. NPM reacted pretty quickly. And it all ended up well, I guess. There's a bunch of points that could have been evaded. First of all, if you don't have two-factor authentication on NPM, go ahead and enable it right now. I don't know why you would not have it enabled. Second of all, if you still don't use a password manager, you're doing security wrong. You should use password manager absolutely without a question and never reuse your passwords, because this is one of the reasons that the maintainer was hacked, because he used the same password everywhere. It's like, it's just asking to be hacked because you're reusing the same password over and over and over again. At some point, some of those services will get compromised. So do yourself a favor and set up a password manager. But yeah, it's like, there's a lot of discussion again around this, about NPM mostly. It's like, you know, how could NPM evade that completely? And there was possibilities like code signing, for example, or scoped authentication tokens that only allow publishing packages, specific packages, and there's no way to know which ones, you know, if you just have the token. But that would mean, you know, more engineering from NPM side, and they are just been silent about that, but we're going to see how that develops. Practically, just having two-factor auth and a strong password would have just stopped the whole thing. But yeah, there you go. So, by the way, if you are updated any of those packages on July 12th, be sure to reset your password if NPM didn't do that for you. And yeah, be sure to just check all your tokens, basically, you know. So it's like all of them were revoked and should no longer work. So I guess you're on the safe side, but better to regenerate them once more just to be sure. All right, next thing we got is Chrome 67 desktop now has a site isolation enabled by default. So there's a pretty big post here on Google, again, the developer platform, web platform blog from Google, talking about what is site isolation. This is a response to the Meltdown and Spectre attacks on the CPUs, and it means that all of the websites are now going to be running in isolated sandboxes, which means they no longer can leak outside, right? So this is mitigating the Spectre and Meltdown vulnerabilities. The like, it's really cool. There's I think there was another article linked here somewhere. Yeah, there you go, on the Google security blog, talking about this specific security issue. And the one of the things that's worth noting is that because of the site isolation, the Chrome will now consume 10 to 13 total memory. So we'll have 10 to 13 total memory overhead. It's like, it's a bit more memory, but the thing is that those are short-lived render processes, right? So that should, you should not feel the impact too much. And again, we knew that mitigating Chrome, Meltdown and Spectre would eat more resources than we are currently using. But, you know, then again, 10-13% over allowing to run Meltdown and Spectre, I will take those 10-13%. All right, next thing we got is NPM joins ECMA International and TC39, which is, I think, pretty neat. So we now have people from NPM working on ECMA International and TC39, helping basically figure out the specs. So there's, like, if you're interested, there's an explanation of why they are joining and how will this affect community. And I think it makes a lot of sense because, I mean, come on. NPM is like the core part of the whole JavaScript infrastructure right now, right? So it's really good they are now talking to the, or they are helping figure out the standards for the whole thing. Maybe they will finally implement code signing. We're gonna see how that goes. All right, next thing we got is releases. There's literally one release this week, at least that's what I found. It is TypeScript 3.0RC. Coming with project references, extracting and spreading parameter lists with tuples, richer tuple types, unknown type, and support for React default props. That's pretty much it. Once again, I'm not a heavy TypeScript user. I've just played around with it a bit, so I have no idea what half of those features mean. If you are using TypeScript, you probably know and you are excited. If you are not, then probably won't tell you anything. Since I don't think I am qualified enough to talk about it in depth, I'm just going to leave it to you guys. And, you know, if you're interested, go ahead and look. All right. Now we are getting to the libs and demos section. This is probably just as big as the articles. We got some neat stuff here, but again, not that much. First thing I got as a highlight is vim.wasm. Somebody compiled Vim to WebAssembly, and you can literally run Vim in your browser, and it actually works as you expected. So it's actually, hello Vim, right? And then you can press and you can use the same highlights. And yeah, you can quit from it. I'm not sure what that actually does. It doesn't seem to do. No, it actually closed it. Oh, I guess quitting is not a good idea. But it is literally the whole Vim ported to WebAssembly, which is quite insane. And it works just as you would expect it to work. There is also like explanation on the build process, how it works and so on and so forth. And also what is Vim. So if you are interested, do have a look. It is an incredible project. Okay, next thing we got is brow.sh. I honestly don't know what it's written in. I haven't investigated, but I thought it's just really awesome because it literally is a browser that runs in your shell. So I'm gonna go ahead over here. This is the shell. And I'm gonna SSH into brow.shell, right? I'm gonna make this window. Yes, I can. There we go. It actually doesn't move, but that should be fine. So it's gonna run the Firefox, and then it's gonna translate the Firefox rendering into the shell rendering. This is how it looks, basically. which is just incredible. Like, this is the examples that you can see here. So it actually renders the text as a proper text, and then it renders the images as pixelated ASCII art, which is just insane. And yes, it works perfectly fine in your console. So there's an example over here. We can make it full screen, and as you can see here, it actually works with just about any website. So if you just have a shell and want to use a browser, there's even a Docker container available. I think it's really awesome. Right, next thing we got is Phenomenon, a 2 kilobyte low-level WebGL API GPU, let me try that again. It's GPU-based and with shader support. So it's pretty, it's not just like very basic one, but it's actually quite complex. I've never worked with WebGL, so I can't really say you anything about that, but it seems to be pretty cool, and I've seen a lot of WebGL people being quite excited about it. So if you are using WebGL, do have a look, you might find it useful. Right, next thing, we got a web remote. Allows you to turn your smartphone with a 3D controller, which is, I guess, the pun into a V-mote, which is, you know, the V joystick. Purely web-based, you don't need any third-party apps or whatever, which I found to be pretty cool. I don't really like this works best in Chrome, so like it's just give me flashbacks, works best in Internet Explorer. It's like, I mean, I guess, yes, Chrome has better support for modern APIs, but come on, that should work in all the other browsers too, right? Surely there's not just some API that are purely supported in Chrome. I mean, I thought they might be some experimental stuff, but yeah. Anyway, that looks pretty nice. So, you know, if you're interested, do have a look. It seems to be pretty fun. Right, next thing we got is Clure. I hope I'm reading that correctly. Is a fastest library for formatting terminal text. It is from Luke Edwards, I believe his name is. Yes, it is Luke Edwards, the guy who created Polka, the Express-like framework that is also super fast. So this time around, he created a super fast coloring library. And there were benchmarks somewhere. Yeah, there we go. There's benchmarks. And as you can see, it is way faster than, for example, Chalk. Like, almost 12 times faster than Chalk, which is just insane. Like, this guy makes some incredible performance optimizations. So if you're looking for a really fast color drawing formatter for terminal, if you're rendering hundreds of thousands of colors per second, then this is probably your choice. Right, next thing we got is Honeypot, a low interaction honeypot that displays real-time attacks. There's a GIF, for example, so if you are interested in seeing what kind of attacks are executed on your servers, you can actually run this thing and then see it all in real time with quite a lot of info and some interesting statistics. So yeah, that seems pretty nice. All right, next, that is the image I opened. Next thing we got is Simple Keyboard, JavaScript on screen virtual keyboard. I guess you could use that for accessibility on the website, although, you know, I imagine that most of the devices right now has stuff like this integrated, but if you need that anyway, well, there you go. It seems to be pretty easy to use. Next thing we got is Toast UI Image Editor, which is a full-featured image editor using Canvas. And as you can see here, it really is a full-featured image editor, including tinting, blending, and there is just a ton of features. So, like, if you look for a thing like that, basically you can build your Instagram with that, I think. Just with this one component, basically. Do have a look at that, seems pretty neat. All right, next thing we got is Proximize, Chainable Promise Proxy, a really, really cool little library that is made with ES6 Proxy and allows you to chain promises without doing any then or await. So the idea is that, you know, I have some promise that returns a value, and then value has the bar property, and then that value has the bus property, and then that has a Qx property, and then you have the final value, right? So you could either write it like this, or you could await all of that, which is also not too nice. And if you wrap it in Proximize, you can literally call the properties. So the library itself is incredibly tiny. The source code is like that, 36 lines of code, and it is really, really, really well made. So I don't know if it actually will break anything, but it seems so straightforward and simple that it would be working in 100% of cases. It's a really neat idea and I really like it. So there's also like practical examples with fetch, for example, which yeah, makes it just amazing. You can literally just say fetch JSON full bar, you know, instead of doing all of that, which is really, really cool. So if you are working a lot with promises that you need to unwrap like this, then have a look at this library. It's pretty handy. Next thing we got is React Shimmer, an image component that simulates the shimmer effect when loading. So it's another one of those loaders, I guess, for images specifically. So as you can see here in a GIF, it's, you know, just like shimmering. Yeah, exactly what you would expect. Pretty straightforward, nothing super complicated about it. So maybe you needed something like this to have a look at that. Next thing we got is Carbon Now Cli. If you didn't know, the Carbon Now is this very nice online service for making a fancy code screenshots. So you just throw in source code and then you can pick a bunch of things and then you can just save image or tweet image or whatever you can imagine, right? And it's made as a website, and now there is a command line version which allows you to also either customize all of that or run in non-interactive mode, which will just generate the image for you from the file, which is quite nice. All right, next thing we got is Singly. It's a single singly circular and linked lists. Let me try that again. Singly circular linear linked lists for ES6. So I don't know if you would actually need something like this in real life code. Let's put it this way, at least in a typical front-end or back-end real-life code, right? So singly circular linear linked lists are a very niche thing, and unless you're doing something very specific with them, you are likely not going to need a data structure like this, but it's really good studying material. So the repo is very good, it has unit tests, it's well-written codes, it has the pretty good explanation of just about everything you can do with it, and it might be a good source for learning them. So if you are looked into the data structures in JavaScript, then have a look at this, maybe you'll pick up something new. Right, next thing we got is a real-time Moon CSS animation. I think it's CSS animation. So as I read on Twitter, it's the slowest animation ever because this moon is animated in real time. So basically whatever the moon is right now, you can actually see it right here. So if you open it like 12 hours later, it's going to be somewhere here, right? So it's pretty neat, and it's really fun to read the code as well. So do have a look at this if you're interested in how it was made. Okay, next thing we got is this lady here got 3.js working in CSS, which is kind of insane. You remember the CSS paintless that we talked about? So this is actually CSS here. This is not a 3D thing there. This is background for a div. And there's a source code over here, and it uses this paint worklet that were introduced in Chrome some time ago, CSS paint worklets. And it is mind-blowing that you can actually do that in browser right now. You can take 3D, you can render it in the background in Service Worker or Paint Worker, right? And then render it as a div background, and it reacts to the mouse, which is even crazier. This is just really cool. All right, and the last thing we got is this password storage disclosures, which I thought was really cool. So it's a website that gathers all the companies that actually talk about how they store passwords, how they hash them, how they solve them, and so on and so forth, with all the security details, and gives them a rating. So if you are interested about the best industry practices, and maybe you are interested how your favorite website does this, you can actually have a look. Seems to be a pretty good one. There's also like, yeah, a lot of explanations and disclosures and everything, and even some ratings here. So yeah, pretty neat. All right, that's it for the libraries. Now we have a bunch of silly stuff. First one is my favorite image from the this week. It's the junior developer versus senior React developer. Well, I mean, it's I've already seen this meme rewritten for like senior C++ developer, senior backend developer, senior big data developer. I think it's just like, I think it should be junior developer versus senior developer. This is very descriptive. This is like every freaking time. I can do this with, how do you call it? It's not a shovel, right? I don't remember how you call this thing. Oh man, now I'm gonna be thinking, how do you call those? What's the English word for it? Wait a second, I have to know. Chat, tell me what's the English word for it. Rake, right, thank you very much. Yes, I can do this with rake and then I will hit myself in the face anyway. So this is all the difference between junior and senior. This is all you should know about programming. All right, and the last thing we got today is, I found this to be absolutely hilarious. This is not JavaScript related, but this is just so my software development that I don't know. It's just the beautiful story of game development. So there's this game called Aliens Colonial Marines. It's been released a long, long, long time ago in 2013, yes. And it was absolute failure, primarily because artificial intelligence in there, the AI of the enemies, the AI of the aliens, were really bad because they were just doing very dumb things and they were basically not acting as they were supposed to, right? So it was a complete failure. And turns out that the reason for that AI behavior was a typo in ini file. So some guy was just like looking at the ini file, some modder, and he found that there was this pecan game, pecan sequence act, attach pound to tether instead of tether. So he fixed that one letter in a config file. Then he ran the game and AI all of a sudden became 10 times smarter. They started behaving properly. They started flanking you. They started attacking you from the crawls and so on and so forth. It's just like... talking again about the necessity of testing and necessity of good quality assurance, right? So one tiny typo broke the whole game, one letter, and one modder who was just messing around with the game, and that was yesterday. So it's like 5 years later, one guy found a typo and fixed the game. Just think about that for a second. I think this story is just incredible. Okay, that's basically it. That's all I have for today, guys. Unless you have anything else you have to share, or you think I missed something, or you have any questions, we can call it a day we can say that's it basically for today, because yeah, I've been playing Warframe for the past week, and I think I kind of it finally clicked for me, and yes. I want to go back playing Warframe because it is freaking amazing. All right, guys. So you have a couple more minutes to send me your questions. Meanwhile, as usual, you can find all the links that I mentioned on the GitHub under buildingxwithjs/bxjsweekly. This is episode 19. The link should be in the description for Twitch channel if you're watching this on Twitch. If you're watching this on YouTube, the link is in the description as well. If you're watching this on dev.2, the link is in the post as usual. And yes, feel free to send me all your links, all your news, all your releases. I will be more than happy to cover them. Yes. All right. Seems like no questions. Thank you for watching. Thank you for supporting me. Have an awesome weekend and I see you next week. Bye.